Australia is in the whirlwind of a discussion about the sexual assault of women and the failure of institutions such as Parliament to deal with the crisis. One young woman, Chanel Contos, has started an Instagram petition calling on schools to teach sexual consent education. Her page contains 5,000 accounts from teenage girls describing sexual assault and coercion. Melinda Tankard-Reist is the director of the women's empowerment group Collective Shout. She supports consent education, but in a powerful argument on the ABC Religion and Ethics website, she says the government must stem the tide of pornography that affects male attitudes to sex. Melinda joined me earlier.
There's strong links in the global literature between what we teach boys at so many levels of popular culture and particularly through pornography and their behaviours. You know, attitudes shape behaviours, and where influencing and negatively affecting the developing sexual templates of boys, and then we're all surprised when they act out.
Yeah, you've used this phrase in a very widely read piece for ABC Religion and Ethics that the world's biggest department of education is pornography. What sort of reach are we talking about there, Melinda?
Oh, we're talking a massive reach. There's estimates that 90% of boys have seen porn by the age of 12 and around 100% by the age of 15. You know, this is our primary sex educator of our boys. It is our most powerful educator about sexuality. And I argued in that ABC piece that this is a global, gigantic dispenser of misogyny and violence. It's our most powerful sexual groomer of young people, and we're seeing the outcome of that. I have so many girls now, even in grade 6 and 7, describing the porn-inspired acts that boys say they want to do to them, that they are subject to groping at school, sexual harassment demands for sexual pictures. I have year 7 girls asking me to please ask the boys to stop talking about the porn they watched last night. I've also had year 7 girls say, please tell the boys to stop looking at porn in the actual classroom. So this has just infiltrated every level of our young people's lives, and girls are bearing the brunt of that every day. For us to talk on the one hand about violence against women and not address the normalization and the eroticization of that violence, bearing in mind that the violent genres of porn are the most popular, we are going to defeat our aims here. Governments have done nothing to protect children from pornography.
Yeah, so what happens if you launch a nationwide program in schools about the importance of consent, and yet you don't address, as you've suggested, through much better regulation, access to pornography?
To illustrate my point, when I was reading through hundreds of the distressing stories that Chanel Contos had collected, a number of these boys had already sat in the consent classes. So,
who later went on to behave abominably.
To become offenders. So my concern is consent being now seen as some kind of, you know, magic bullet to get us out of this mess? It won't be enough. And the girls describe being worn down, being pressured, being coerced, and a lot of times boys aimed for the opposite. They didn't want consent. They're not interested because the conquest is in the taking, in helping yourself. And as I argued in that piece, sexual gratification will trump empathy, you know, every time, when this is how boys learn to be sexual and how to treat women, by being, you know, hooked up to this mammoth dispenser of hatred and violence and misogyny.
You've even used a phrase that boys are being radicalized through porn. What do you mean by that?
Yes, it's actually the phrase of James Evans from the UK, who is a colleague, and he wrote the most profound and compelling piece I've read in my life. And as you know, I've been working on this issue for a while, about the descent into porn. And he describes a process of radicalization, how porn changed the way he saw women, how he objectified every woman he saw. He saw every woman as up for grabs. And he said he had to relearn empathy. He had to relearn the idea that women are actually human and shouldn't be treated this way. And he believes we need a de-radicalization program for boys and men, because he argues very profoundly that porn has radicalized boys and men into this kind of behavior.
I know I'm going to get feedback here, Melinda, on this issue. I always do. Some people are going to accuse you of approaching this from a moral perspective, that you're moralizing. I mean, how do you respond to that?
Look, these kind of stereotypes that are spouted by people with vested interests don't hold anymore. They really don't hold at all. The body of evidence now is very weighty. Global meta-analysis of the research linking porn consumption with sexual aggression, with coercion, that those who consume porn will become more tolerant of sexual harassment, that porn leads to an acceptance of rape myths, that no means yes, that it breeds entitlement. This is a solid body of literature now and finally is being taken seriously. And parents are desperate, schools are desperate. Child development experts saying that they're now treating 6- and 7-, 8-year-olds for inappropriate sexual behaviour of our young people. It's become a public health crisis that needs to be addressed urgently.
There are some concrete ways in which this is being addressed. What is Canada doing to investigate the world's biggest purveyor of pornography and, often very violent pornography?
Yes, well, Collective Shout, the movement that I co-founded 10 years ago, has been part of a global campaign with our global partners. We actually were the first to start to expose what we found on Pornhub. Back in 2016, rape videos, trafficking, non-consensual images there, underage girls, extreme racism, extreme misogyny. And with our global partners, we helped to get up an investigation into Pornhub, which is owned by MindGeek, the parent company, which is headquartered in Canada. And the Canadian Parliament, its Ethics Committee, decided to investigate the claims and has heard a massive amount of evidence, which has collated. And the next step now will be a criminal investigation for a hosting of essentially crimes against women and girls. And we would welcome that investigation to send a signal that the global porn industry just cannot get away with this, that it's causing harms, it's engaging in criminal activity and distorting and shaping and harming an entire generation of young people on top of it.
And isn't the Australian Parliament, the House of Representatives, also inquiring into this matter?
Andrew, that inquiry was finalised 1 year ago this month, and we are still waiting on the federal government to respond. That inquiry was into age verification systems for children to protect them from online gaming sites and from pornography exposure. And that committee recommended looking into an age verification proof of age system to at least have some basic protection so that little kids aren't entering, you know, torture porn, rape porn and sadism sites. And we don't quite understand the delay. We would really like to know if the government is serious about its ethical responsibilities, especially to the most vulnerable among us.
Melinda, who would be pushing back against something as basic as an age verification check so that 12 and 13 and 14-year-olds could not access pornography? Who would be pushing back against that?
You'd think we could find some common ground, Andrew, but no, the vested interests that need to develop, need to grow a new market of consumers, don't want any limits at all, not even to protect children from damaging content. You know, we are up against a global industry worth billions of dollars, and they don't want anything to stand in the way between themselves and new young consumers.
That's Melinda Tankard-Reist of the group Collective Shout. She's always worth listening to and reading, by the way. Her book is called Big Porn, Inc., Exposing the Harms of the Global Pornography Industry.